Good afternoon, everyone. We're back. It's March 9th, 2017. We're going to a journey, another adventure. So sit back, relax, and just enjoy the ride. We'll be there in a bit. Thank you. Paisano Drive, you know, we're still right here on the very edge of Texas and New Mexico. I'm not sure if New Mexico is right there to your right. I know the Rio Grande, that's the Rio Grande right there. You can barely see it. As you can see, it's dried up, it's been dammed. No, but that's the famous Rio Grande, I guess, from the old west. Getting closer to the area where Texas and New Mexico meet, and Mexico, the country of Mexico. Somewhere along right here, Texas, New Mexico, and the state of Chihuahua of Mexico meet somewhere right here in this area. The other side of the Rio Grande. I'm not sure exactly where. I'm assuming right there across the river, somewhere in that little area. That's where the three states meet. One being a state in the country of Mexico. Those houses right there are the outskirts of Juarez. You know, one thing I noticed when I first moved to El Paso was a heavy presence of law enforcement. You know, I always see Border Patrol patrolling the border highway along Texas, you know, in Mexico. You know, El Paso is a very unique geographic location, you know, pretty much bordering Mexico. There's a heavy presence of U.S. Border Patrol. U.S. Border Patrol was established in 1924, but the history of Border Patrol actually goes as much earlier here in El Paso. You know, in 1904, guardsmen or watchmen patrolled the border to enforce the Chinese Exclusion Act, restricting the illegal entry of Chinese immigrants from Mexico. You know, this is a famous, you know, actually not famous, but this is a wall right here. Pretty much delays the entry of illegal immigrants into the United States. You know, that's Juarez, Mexico, just right across, about 100 feet. 100 feet from where I'm driving, that's Juarez. You know, over here to my left, it's El Paso, Texas. But like I said earlier, there's a strong presence of law enforcement. We have, you know, El Paso PD, which was established in 1884, you know, led by city marshals, which at the time was the equivalent of chief of police. You know, El Paso's first sheriff was appointed in 1852, and his name was William Ford. El Paso has lots of history in law enforcement, you know, and ever since the 1800s. You know, El Paso's a pretty safe city to live, you know, but a lot of the research that I've gathered, from what I understand, El Paso was a very violent city at the time, back in the late 1800s. It is said that Wyatt Earp was offered the position of sheriff or city marshal. I'm not sure which one, but he respectfully declined because Wyatt Earp stated that El Paso was too dangerous, too violent of a city or a town, you know. So he ended up going to Tombstone. You know, well, you know the story behind Tombstone, right? The OK Corral. But nowadays El Paso is very, very calm, very safe. starting to flourish as a city. Nice place to live, nice weather. And let's go to our next destination. Right now, they're setting a trolley system in El Paso. They used to have a trolley system way back from the late 1800s till I don't know when in the 1900s, but they pretty much took it down, and I guess they're bringing it back. Over here to your left, Southwest University Park, the home of El Paso Chihuahuas. Very, very good baseball team. April 6th is opening day. It's the El Paso History Museum. And actually, sorry, earlier that was El Paso. And we're back. We're back in San Jacinto Plaza. But today we're not going to talk about San Jacinto Plaza. Today we're going to talk about the Old West here in El Paso. El Paso has a very famous gunslinger. His name is John Wesley Hardin. John Wesley Hardin was born in 1853. He was a notorious gunslinger at the time. His father was James Gibb Hardin, a preacher and circuit rider, and his mother was Mary Elizabeth Dixon. John Wesley Hardin was named after John Wesley, the founder of the Methodist Christian denomination. We're here, we're gonna go explore the Acme Saloon. The building is still here, which is the building where John Wesley Hardin was killed. Hardin is considered an American gunslinger and an old West outlaw. You know, he was murdered in the Acme Saloon here in San Antonio Street. The Acme Saloon building is still there. You know, at one point he claimed that he killed 42 men, but newspapers at the time claimed he only killed 27. You know, either way, 42, 27, or even 50, or even 10, that's a lot of people to kill in one's lifetime. I don't think anyone can get away with that nowadays. But the Acme Saloon is right here in the corner of Mesa and San Antonio Street. There's actually a plaque there, and we're gonna read that plaque to see what it says. You know, but Hardin was constantly running from the law throughout his youth, his 20s and 30s. He was captured a few times, escaped captured. You know, it is said that he actually murdered his captors at one time. You know, but he was finally caught in Florida, served about 14 years in prison, where he studied law and where he wrote an autobiography. And it is said it was a very biased autobiography. You know, most of his claims cannot be confirmed. Okay, El Paso, I'm right here in the corner of Mesa Street and San Antonio Street. This building right behind me, it's the actual building. The Acme Saloon. It's not the Acme Saloon anymore, obviously, but this is the exact same building. I don't know if it used to look like this back then, but this is the exact same building where John Wesley Hardin was killed. Now, just imagine bat doors. You know, if you've seen Westerns where you have these bat doors that swing open to enter the buildings, especially the saloons. Now, as the story goes, the way John Wesley Hardin died, well, what happened was that John Selmans Jr. arrested M. Rose. M. Rose was a lover, acquaintance, or friend of John Wesley Hardin. You know, she got arrested for brandishing a gun. At the time in the 1880s, there was already an ordinance where it was prohibited to carry a pistol on city limits. Well, Hardin heard of the incident of the arrest. He approached John Selmans Jr. They had an altercation, and the altercation led to the pistol whipping of John Selmans Jr. by John Wesley Hardin. Well, John Selmans Sr., who was a constable at the time, the father, found out about the altercation between his son and Hardin and went out looking for him. Well, he found him at the Acme Saloon right here, which is now a store where they sell dresses for quinceañeras and weddings. He found him inside, approached him, and shot him in the back of the head. Well, when John Wesley Hardin was lying on the floor dying, John Selmans Sr. shot him 3 more times, hitting him twice, which ended his life. The very next day, John Hardin John Wesley Hardin was buried at Concordia Cemetery. And in a few more minutes, we're gonna head over to Concordia Cemetery, which the history of Concordia Cemetery goes back over 100 years. Well, before we end the tour here on San Antonio Street and Mesa Street, this is a famous plaque right here. And it says, John Wesley Hardin, the West's most feared gunman killer of at least 27 men, was shot dead in the Acme Saloon on this side, August 19th, 1895. Hardin was shot in the back of the head by El Paso Constable John Selman. At Selman's trial, a witness testified, if Hardin was shot in the eye, it was excellent marksmanship. If he was shot in the back, it was excellent judgment. Selman, out on bail a few months later, was killed in a gunfight. Presented by the State National Bank of El Paso, Texas, November 19th, 1962. Well, like I said before, John Wesley Hardin was a notorious gunslinger. They're saying that he was very fast and very accurate. It was said that there was a gunfight between John Wesley Hardin and Billy the Kid. Billy the Kid would have shot first, but John Wesley Hardin would have won because he was more accurate. This is downtown El Paso in the 1880s. As you can see, there's no concrete or asphalt on the streets. There's still dirt. 1880s, you guys. This is how El Paso used to look. This is the era of the gunslinger, of the Old West. Very bustling town at the time. Check it out. That's pretty neat, man. Horses and carriages. That's really neat. I wish El Paso had a lot of these buildings. A lot of these buildings were torn down. Hello, we're back. It's March 9th, 2017. We're in Concordia Cemetery. As you can see, Concordia Cemetery is very old. Its roots, its history goes back over 100 years. This place was settled by Hugh Stevenson, Kentucky born, Missouri native. You know, Hugh Stevenson moved to El Paso area around 1824. He married Juana Maria Escarate from the prominent Escarate family. I'm assuming Escarate Park here in El Paso, Texas is named after the Escarate family. Well, we're here in Concordia Cemetery. Well, we're looking for John Wesley Hardin's grave. But first, there's a grave, actually two gravestones that I want to see. You know, one has been here since 1976 and the other 2002. You know, when I was doing my research, I was reading that John Wesley Hardin's descendants were pretty much wanting to exhume his body, to take his body back to where his family is from at this current age. Or I don't know if it, or they wanted to take it back where John Wesley Hardin was born in Bonham, Texas. But as you can see, the cemetery pretty much looks like a cemetery from the 1800s, you know. Back in the day, very old. There's lots of people buried here from the 1800s till now. I was walking along at the entrance of the cemetery, and I noticed a tombstone that said Schuster. I don't know if the tombstone belongs to Dr. Schuster, who I've read pretty much founded the first hospital in El Paso, the Providential or Providence. I think the reason why it's called Providence because the citizens of El Paso referred to the hospital as a Providential. But I don't know if it's part of the Schuster family, which is the same person I'm talking about, just a different Schuster. We're getting near the two graves that I'm looking for. I haven't been here since 2002. But here we are. As you can see, check out all these graves. It's a very old cemetery, very, very old. From what I read, the first person buried here was Juana Maria Azcárate. This area of Azcárate, Concordia Cemetery was part of Hugh Stevenson's ranch, you know, and actually I-10, which you can actually see right there, was part of the ranch. And at one point, there was another military post here. Well, these are the two graves, you know, my grandparents. I never met my grandfather. I was born, actually, well, died a few months before I was born, my grandma. But my grandparents are buried here in Concordia. As I'm walking along, I see a lot of old tombstones. A lot of broken ones. A lot of crosses that are still, that were made out of wood. Check it out. It looks like a crypt, small little crypt. I don't know if it's called a crypt. That's pretty cool. It's a very, very old cemetery. I think there's a sign somewhere that talks a little bit about the history of Concordia. Let's see if we can find it. Camp Concordia, the United States Army first post in what is now El Paso, was established in 1849 at the place called Smith's Ranch, located in current downtown area. The post was abandoned in 1851 when the troops moved to New Mexico's Fort Fillmore. A second El Paso post was erected at McGoffinsville in 1853 during the Civil War. The post was occupied by both Union and Confederate forces. In early 1868, flooding from the Rio Grande caused major damage to the post, which was then relocated 3 miles east to a new site on El Rancho de la Concordia, owned by early El Paso settlers Hugh and Juana Stevenson, and renamed Camp Concordia. The following year, 1869, the post was christened with the new name Fort Bliss. The fort lasted 9 years at this location before being dismantled in January 1877. The actual site of this original Fort Bliss is located at 4001 Durazno Street, just below the Highway 54 and I-10 interchange. If you go to Concordia's website, they offer ghost tours. I think it's every first Saturday of the month. I'm gonna try one. I love attending ghost tours. There's also El Paso ghost tours, you know, a different paranormal society. Check it out. This is pretty insane. The grave of the deadliest gunslinger of the West. That's hard. JWH, his grave. There's a plaque stating John Wesley Hardin, May 26, 1853. August 19th, 1895. There's another plaque right here. Oh, we found it. John Wesley Hardin's grave, notorious gunslinger of the Old West, late 1800s, here in El Paso. El Paso's famous gunslinger, his grave. I guess it's like visiting Billy the Kid's grave or the Clanton's grave. You know, the famous Clantons from Tombstone.
We're I'm running out of daylight. I hope you enjoyed this video. It was very fun to film today. John Wesley Hardin, El Paso's very own gunslinger, an outlaw of the Old West. Oh man, I don't know why I like doing that. Come visit Concordia, the Texas historic site. I've been walking around and I've been noticing there's a lot of empty lots. I wonder if you can still be buried here. I was told you can't because it's a historic site, but I don't know. You know, I guess people can probably still be buried here. You know, but before I go, thank you for joining me in this journey and adventure. You know, enjoying the sights, the sounds of downtown El Paso, of Concordia, learning history with me. You know, I still have lots to learn from El Paso. El Paso has lots of history, lots of rich history. You know, we shall continue to explore El Paso and other sites along the Southwest. But for now, thank you for joining me. Thank you. Walking along, trying to find the exit. They closed me, they locked me in the cemetery. I think I'm gonna have to jump the fence. I hope I don't get arrested for trespassing since the cemetery is closed. Oh well, it's too funny.